massing for the second part of that coupling, Janáček's Glagolitic Mass. Like Beethoven, Janáček's manuscripts suggest that he wrote in a frenzy of activity, a great white heat. It's almost as though the human hand was incapable of getting the ideas from the mind to the paper fast enough. And the result is music of wonderful spontaneity, unorthodox orchestration, considered crude in Janáček's day, but to us hugely exhilarating. Even in a setting of the Mass, Janáček managed to do the unusual. He was not, as I suggested earlier, religious in a conventional sense, but a friend, a priest, suggested that Janáček use the old Slavonic language, which was written with the Glagolitic alphabet. Now this nationalistic element solved for Janáček the problem of writing a straightforward religious Mass. The operatic nature of Janáček's musical character is never far beneath the surface, and Janáček himself mentioned the noise and lightning flashes when the heavens are rent open in the credo. And yet, these dramatic strokes consistently underline the protestations of faith, the calamitous event of the crucifixion, and the extreme tenderness and supplication of a particularly beautiful Agnus Dei. As you'll have gathered, the movements follow in traditional Catholic pattern: Kyrie, Gloria, Credo, Sanctus, Benedictus, and Agnus Dei. In addition, there's an orchestral introduction and two instrumental movements at the close. The famous organ solo, which will be played by Ian Tracey, and then for the final bars, a festive intrada with rejoicing trumpets. Belonging to the glorious late flowering of Janáček's last years, the Glagolitic Mass has all the hallmarks of the composer at his greatest: vibrant rhythms, idiosyncratic melodies, and exuberant orchestration. Indeed, the opening pages could only be by the composer of the Sinfonietta. But above all, as with the Eroica, the Glagolitic Mass speaks to us on a spiritual and personal level that is quite individual. And it's surely this combination of qualities that is the prerogative of the truly great composer. Now Malcolm Stewart comes back to take his place at the first desk of the Royal Liverpool Philharmonic Orchestra. And I imagine the A will come, as indeed it is coming, from the organist Ian Tracey, who's also the chorus master of the choir. Well, the choir themselves are resplendent in their new title of Royal Liverpool Philharmonic Choir. Her Majesty the Queen has just become their patron as they, like the orchestra, celebrate their 150 years of music making. They're joined tonight by members of the BBC Symphony Chorus for this performance of the Glagolitic Mass, which was incidentally first performed in Brno in 1927. Needless to say, Janáček is very close to the heart of Libor Pešek. And now he comes onto the platform with the soloists. The mezzo-soprano, Ameral Gunson, the soprano, Jane Eaglen, the tenor, John Mitchinson, and the bass, Michael George. The Glagolitic Mass by Janáček.
Thank you. doppelt diesen Ort, du Kaspetta, ist Maria Dieri.
Thank you.
Yet more liberating trumpets, bringing to a close Janáček's Glagolitic Mass. Ian Balmain, the principal trumpet, being brought to his feet with his colleagues there. Libor Pešek, who conducted the mass forces. What an extraordinarily exciting work it is. And yet, I hope you'll agree, not without the spiritual element that I spoke of. The soprano soloist was Jane Eaglen. The mezzo-soprano, Ameral Gunson, just leaving the platform now. The tenor, John Mitchinson, and the bass, Michael George. With the BBC Symphony Chorus, whose chorus master is Stephen Jackson, and the Royal Liverpool Philharmonic chorus master Ian Tracey, who of course also played the organ. By the way, I noticed that there was a fire extinguisher next to the organ. I can see why they thought it might be needed, but in the event, the great beast performed well, as did Ian Tracey, who I expect has made... Oh, there's the fire extinguisher. One of the cameramen on BBC Two has managed to pick it up. Here are the soloists who have come to the front of the platform. And with them, Ian Tracey. A crescendo of applause for Mr. Tracey after his performance of that demanding solo. Ian Tracey also applauding the chorus. It must have been quite a daunting task to learn this work in Czech, or perhaps I should say the Slavonic language, which of course is where the work gets its title, Glagolitic Mass. I don't speak Czech, but it certainly sounded pretty convincing to me. Well, the RLPO appear here tonight thanks to financial assistance from Pilkington PLC. I mentioned the echoes of the Sinfonietta, and you might like to know that the LSO are playing the Sinfonietta, that's the London Symphony Orchestra, here at the Proms on the 12th of September, when the conductor will be Michael Tilson Thomas. So if you'd like to listen on Radio 3, you'll be able to decide whether my musical analogy was correct. I think this is what I would call a packed hall, and the audience clearly deeply appreciated that performance of Janáček's Glagolitic Mass, masterminded by the Czech conductor Libor Pešek. I see that he studied with some very famous Czech names, Karel Ančel, Václav Neumann, and Václav Smetáček at Prague City's Academy of Musical Arts. Promenaders in rhythmic mood to match Janáček. The soloists come back onto the platform. Ameral Gunson, Jane Eaglen, John Mitchinson, Ian Tracey, Stephen Jackson, Michael George, and of course, Libor Pešek. The entire entourage rise to their feet, chorus and orchestra. Well, that brings us to the end of this evening's Prom. BBC Two and Radio 3 will join forces again to bring you live Bruckner's Symphony No. 5, played by the BBC Symphony Orchestra, conducted by Gunter Wand, which promises to be something of a special occasion. That'll be next Sunday, but now there's a whole week of Proms till then, so from the Royal Albert Hall, a very good night to you.